And God gave Abraham the circumcision
sign.
After he had accepted God on his
promise
and walked out into a strange country. See, it is a sign. And all his children and his seed after him should have this sign in their flesh, because it is a distinction. It was to separate them from all other people. This sign of circumcision. And that's what God used today. Is the sign of circumcision of the heart. The Holy Spirit. That makes God's church a separated people from all other creeds, faiths and denominations.
Amen.
Amen. Praise be the name of the Lord. Isn't the Lord wonderful tonight?
How
many of you are happy to be around?
Amen.
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 Brother Makina is sitting right at the back.
Brother Makina, brother
from Durban, bless my brother. He has not been feeling well, but he's fine by the grace of God.
Stabulu
is in service.
Stabulu to our service in us.
All the way from Accra. God bless you, sister. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Elias. Elias.
Brother Elias.
He's at the back also. All the way from Eastern Cape.
From Eastern Cape.
South Africa. God bless you.
Amen.
Amen. We give God the praises.
Amen.
He deserves all the praises. Amen.
Amen.
Chapter 17 of the book of Genesis is giving an account where God is making a covenant of men. And in this covenant, we are seeing something new. We never read about it before. And history never heard anything like this before. And God is introducing this covenant. And he's bringing something that's never heard of before. Amen.
Amen.
That Abraham must have a sign of distinction between him, his children, and the rest of the other nations. And that was a sign of circumcision. Amen.
Amen.
So, starting from Abraham,
Abraham
and all that were in his house, they were supposed to have this sign of distinction. Wherever they go under this earth, this was a sign. Amen.
Amen.
And God wanted it that way. Because whenever God does his thing, he will never consult anybody. He does everything according to his own will. Amen.
Amen.
And that was in the Old Testament. And Abraham, remember, at this particular time, Isaac was not even there. But Ishmael was there. He also was circumcised. Amen.
Amen.
And we can say he was a Gentile still.
Amen.
Amen. But God made a covenant with him. And all the children and that will come after him. We are not the seed of Abraham on the flesh.
Amen.
Amen. But we are the children of Abraham in the spirit. Because of the promise in Jesus Christ. We are not just the seed of Abraham, but we are the royal seed. We have got royalty in us. Is that right?
Amen.
So we're not just mere people. We have got royalty. But if you have got royalty, you must know that you have got dominion.
Amen.
You you have got something that you are using to rule with.
Amen.
If you have got royalty, you're not running away. But you have got royalty, they are running
out
from
you.
Is that true? We are the royal seed of
Abraham.
So devils come one way to us, but they go away seven times.
Is that
the promise you have? Because you are royalty. Is that right?
Amen.
Now you also must remember that whatever inheritance you have depends on what kind of father you have. The book of Ezekiel says the heathens will come. Amen. And they say our fathers gave us wrong inheritance. Amen.
Amen.
But we are coming. Not as Gentiles.
Amen.
Amen. Because we got a foundation. Is that right?
Amen.
The apostles and the prophets,
they are
our foundation. Where this house is fitly standing. We're not coming as cowards. We're coming with royalty. Amen. We're not looking at natural inheritance. Because all these things, they can be stolen. They can be burned. Tomorrow it's not there. But we have got inheritance, which Peter says has been stored up in heaven for us, ready to be revealed in this last day. Amen.
Amen.
No moth, no rust can take it away. But we come at this time when all these promises are gathering here for us. Amen. So, the prophet said in the quote we read that circumcision is a type of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
And we are so thankful that the messages that came in between here, it was not like to break our series, but God was helping us move into other avenues to make sure we can understand, amen, what God has as a purpose for us. Isn't he wonderful? Amen.
Amen.
So it's a type of the Holy Ghost. It's a circumcision is a type of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And as it was then, if any man child refused circumcision, it meant he was out of the covenant and must be away from the children of Israel. He is an outcast. Is that right? Because he refuses to be part of the covenant of God. Inasmuch as it was strict that time, I believe it also is as strict as that
time.
Is that right? And we read a quote the other time where the prophet says the difference, there's a big difference between a Christian with the Holy Ghost and one who doesn't have. Because the one who doesn't have is only professing. He doesn't have victory. But the one with the Holy Ghost, he has got victory all the time. He is on the hallelujah side. It doesn't matter what kind of problems come. He is always victorious. The word of God is on his side. He is a winner on his
side.
It's alright? Because he is marked. Amen.
Amen.
When the Holy Ghost comes around, he knows those who are his. Is that true?
Amen.
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 And I believe it must be your desire that you be a part of the family of God by having this mark of distinction. So the difference between a message believer and the one who is not is the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Is that right?
Amen.
Now, the Holy Ghost does not mean that you are a message believer. Or it doesn't mean that when you come to a message church, you automatically have the Holy Spirit.
No.
The men who have come around, and they're just as raw as before. Is that right? You can never say something that they don't like. Then you're going to see their color. Although they've been around a long time, if you cross their path only, then they're going to tell you, you don't know me. And it's true. Because the one that we know is the Holy Ghost, who dwells in you. But this other guy that says, you don't know me. That's something else.
Amen.
So it's not just going to a message church, but having the Holy Ghost in you. He is the inside teacher who speaks to you when everybody else doesn't speak to you. Is that right? He is the inside teacher who tells you quietly. That still small voice. Whenever you are trying to go the wrong direction, when there's a lot of noise everywhere else, that is telling you, keep going, keep going. But this little voice tells you, be careful. Don't go that direction. He is inside. He doesn't speak from outside. Is that right? When you buy the wrong dress, he's the one that tells you, this is not right for you. Is that right? When you say something wrong, he tells you, hey, be careful. What did you say? Fix that up. Ask for forgiveness. That's not the way to say it. Is that right? When you look at somebody in a wrong way, the voice says, hey, what are you doing? Put your eyes the other side. He is there to correct you. We need him. Is that right? When you say the wrong text, amen. Before you finish writing, before you put your full stop, that voice tells you, delete. Delete. It's not right. How can you do that? Brother, the prophet says it's like you've taken something from a child. And the child is crying. You know that kind of feeling? That's the kind of infliction you put on. To say you cannot do. We need that inside you. Is that right? Whenever you pick a book to read, he tells you, that's not for believers. That book is not for believers. Is that right? And if you are full of the Holy Ghost, do you know what you do? You put it down. It's not yours. That's not inherited. You have crossed the line. You have gone in the other direction.
Hallelujah.
Is that right? We need somebody who can speak to us all the time. Look at what happened before the Holy Ghost came. Peter and Judas Iscariot. Brother, they're always at
loggerheads.
Amen. When Peter asked Jesus, how many times can you forgive? I believe it must have been Brother Judas, who was always raving on him. Amen. And Jesus told him
7 times.
But after the Holy Ghost came,
all
the day of Pentecost, that question never came again. Is that right? Because he gives the answers on time. Praise God. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost is what we need. Even when you you are in argument, and somebody is pushing into a corner about what you believe, is that right? The Holy Ghost gives you scripture right on time. It doesn't matter how much of a non-reader you are, but the Holy Ghost is the author of the scripture. He knows what the scripture is, and he brings it to you. Is that right? How many times did Brother Branham say Peter was ignorant? But he never even was able to sign his name. That's what the prophet said. But on the day of Pentecost, when the question came, these people are drunk with the new wine. Amen. Peter rose up. He said, we are not as drunk as you may suppose. But this is that. God was spoken by John the prophet. Hallelujah. Because the Holy Ghost, he caused the scripture. Is that right? So he gives you the scripture at the right time. So the Holy Ghost is not daft. He is the author of the word. Amen. He gives you the right scripture at the right time. He gives you the right example at the right time. Is that right? He brings to memory all those things that's necessary. Have you ever noticed, Brother Branham, even in 1965, he would tell you events that happened in 1933 about his healing campaign. He was a sister who was like this, and she said this, and this one said this. After 30 years, he still remembered what happened. Was that the man? Was it because he was able to remember? No, sir. It was the Holy Ghost. You need that? No, that. Is that right? You need the Holy Ghost in your life. Is that right? So that it must be good for you. Then people are going to say, what is happening to this man? Because there is a mark on your life that the rest of the world does not have. I'm reading paragraph 50. That's what's the matter. We don't get sealed so much. Amen. We are too loose about things. When the inspector goes through you to inspect your life, to see if you are not just a little loose about things. Is that right? Because I said the Holy Ghost is a seal to show that everything in this truck is paid well. Everything in this container is paid well. And they've got to seal it, maybe with aluminium and maybe plus a key. And this truck is never opened until it gets to the destination. When the driver finally gives the papers to the owner, the receiver, they pick the papers. Amen. Then these are the ones that must unseal. Because it has gone to its destination. Is that right? So you don't unseal it halfway. When it comes to its destination, then the owners of the goods, they've got the papers. They read the whole list of the contents. Is that right? Then they say, okay. They go and unseal. All the way as they were coming, there was no shaking. Everything was paid right. So that not even a rat can get through. There is no space for it. It is paid correct. Amen. So when they unseal, they open up. And they want to count one by one to see if the contents in there? Is it like what is written
here?
Is that right? It must be because there was no understanding in between. So the Holy Ghost is a seal. And God is an inspector. He looks into your life to check everything is in order. Is that right? He checks this scripture. Is it okay with you? Have you been baptized correctly? Did you repent of your sin? Did you fix up this? The book you stole? Did you take it back? That wardrobe you stole? Did you take it back? You borrowed that shoe? Did you take it back? You borrowed that jacket? Did you take it back? Is that right? He is checking, he is the inspector. And every time we go to church, the inspector comes in and he looks into our life to check if everything is in order before he seals you with the Holy Ghost. Is that right? So this is where the prophet is talking about here. Is that right? Are you not just a little loose about things? Little loose about your prayer life? Little loose about your temper? Little loose about that tongue to talk about others? You'll never seal that car. Amen. Some dirty habits. Some vile things. Some vulgarity man. He can't seal that. Is that right? Is he talking about you? Is he talking about you? Are you loose about your temper? Okay, everybody's got a certain amount of temper. But how do you work on it? You need a bit of pressure in your life in order for you to do things. Understand? You need a little bit of something that is going to push you in order for you to do something. But now, the devil wants to fight here. How do you control that temper? Some even tell you, brother, I want you to know before we talk, I'm high tempered. So please, you must know your life. Don't talk too much about that. Otherwise, I don't know what I will happen. You're loose. You don't know what to do with your temper. What is the prophet say? Sweeten your temper with prayer. Is that right? So you can control that. James tells us in the Bible that a tongue is one of the smallest members in your body. But that one, it can glorify God. Amen. Or it will break relationships. It's a little member that must be guarded very well. The stern of the ship is the one that is going to guide the direction. It's right at the back. If it turns like this, the ship goes west. If it turns like this, the ship goes the other direction. You don't even see it. But it's right in the bottom of the, right inside the water. But it is turning the ship from behind here. That's what James said. Is that right? Amen. So you don't see it because it's underwater. But we don't see that tongue. It's in the mouth. But that one, if you don't control that one, you make many, many enemies. Or you make many, many friends. Amen. But brother, sister, let that member be under control. Otherwise, he will not seal you because you talk too much. People are avoiding talking to you because they say, that brother, that sister is a dot com. Because all issues you want, just go to them. Then you're going to read everything. Brother, sister, don't ever allow that label to be on you. Amen. But make sure people desire to talk to you. Because you've got something good that you're going to give to people. Is that right? That is exactly what we need. Because when you're full of the Holy Ghost, everything that comes out of you is inspiring. It's like scripture. Is that right?
Amen.
Because look at the life of Abraham. This man was not, he didn't need to be full of the Holy Ghost. He moved by inspiration. Whatever he was doing, his speech and everything about him until it became Bible to us. Paul had to be baptized of the Holy Ghost and he became a different man altogether. And all that he said became Bible to us. Is that true? When he stood before Agrippa, give me ear, I want to speak. Is that right? The whole speech became Bible talk. But do you know, if you also are full of the Holy Ghost the same way, whatever you go to say, it is lined up in the scripture. Many times you don't understand what you are talking about. Is that right? But unknowingly, you're quoting scripture. Is that true? That is what the Holy Ghost is all about. Yeah, let me finish this part here. Amen.
Amen.
So, he can't seal that car.
Okay.
But when he's found anything in his place, the
inspector,
then he seals it. David, anybody open that seal until that car is reaching destination? To where he sealed for? Amen.
Then
it is, touch not my anointed. Do my prophets no harm? For I say unto you, it'd be better for you that millstone was hanged
to your neck.
Amen. And you were drowned in the depths of the sea.
That
even to try to offend or check a little on the list of this.
Hallelujah.
You see what it means? Amen. May God help us, brothers. Is that right? So, did the prophet speak about dirty habits?
1959.
Before many of you were born, he calls it dirty habits. But today, you don't want to call it dirty habits, you call it pornography. But a person with the Holy Ghost, he runs away from that. Young people, do you hear what I say? If you get to be full of the Holy Ghost, that's no longer your direction. That's no longer your direction. Amen.
Amen.
The way you talk and the way you do your thing. Amen. You know I'm full of the Holy Ghost. I don't want my mind to be occupied with nonsense.
Yeah.
I want to be right with God. God is going to be happy with you. Amen.
Amen.
And when you pray, after you clean up this body, God is going to come and dwell
with you.
Because you are dwelling place of the living God. Amen.
Amen.
That's why we got to clean up ourselves. Because Almighty God has got But you're taking somebody's place.
Who
was supposed to come through here? So before they waste their space, they must check. Do you have the papers? Is your visa ready? Is it up to date? Is that right? So it is very, very important. Amen. That you do all the procedures this
time
before you start the journey. Amen. If you are afraid of the interview in the embassy, don't think about God. Is
that
right? Because must ask you, why do you want to go? When are you coming back? Are you sure you're coming back? Amen. But in this world, the world must make sure you're coming back. But our heavenly kingdom, they want to make sure you're not coming back. Oh, isn't that wonderful? Because it's one way. Then you must be assured you're going. Hallelujah. And that assurance is the Holy Ghost. Amen. So the people of this world are trying to take what God has. Is that right? But theirs is two ways. You go, but you come back. But in our case, we go one way. Amen. So you must have it before you start your journey. You must make sure you are going. Yes, brother, sister. That's the Christian life. Why would you waste your time? You might know all the songs we sing in church. You might know all the different brothers and sisters in church. But you don't even assurance
or
connection with the heavenly kingdom. So you're wasting your time. But we must make sure while we're still on this time, and still able, you must be going. You must know I am going.
Paragraph 60.
Amen. Now the advocate. John, 1 John.
No, I don't know. 2:12.
Now let's read that just minute. Amen. He says 1 John 1,
1 John and 2, verse 12.
I've got this wrote down. Amen. My little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, who is the advocate? Jesus Christ the righteous. Amen.
Amen.
And he is the propitiation of our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole
world.
Is that right?
Amen.
This is what he does for us.
Those are not teachers.
Amen.
Amen.
What is the Holy Ghost?
He's
an advocate. Amen. What is an advocate? What does he do? Make an advocate.
Amen.
Amen. It has mercy. It stands in your place.
Amen.
It does things that you can't do. Amen. It's a propitiation for your sins. It's your righteousness. It's your healing. It's your life. It's your resurrection. It's all that God has for you. He is an advocate. Amen.
Amen.
Have you ever attended any court case? Many times the judge wants to make sure he doesn't speak to you personally. Because you don't know the legal language. Because the judge uses legal language. So he wants to make sure you're represented. Somebody has got to stand for you. Is that right? And you have got to look for somebody that knows what he is doing. You don't want somebody that is going to stammer on your behalf. But you want somebody that has got history.
Yeah.
That But you overcame that case in that case.
And
that
case in that case.
You stood on this one and this one.
And
you said, I don't care how much I'm going to spend.
Because
I know that I am right. I want to make sure I overcome.
So you look
for an advocate. Is that right?
Amen.
But now I want you to know. If you have gotten to right in the court, the advocate sits with you. And he talks to you. He asks you questions about the situation, about the problem, about that case. And he goes round and round to make sure he has got all information. If you must win the case, tell him the truth. Is that right? And tell him the truth. And tell him everything. Even what he never asked you. You tell him, I believe you also must know this. This and this. And he writes everything. Why? He wants to stand for you. Not just that the case must go and be finished. He wants to make sure he wins his case. Because he's standing for you. This is why you hired him.
Those are our coca.
So that he can stand for you.
Amen.
Is that right?
Amen.
Now, the Bible tells us that the devil
Satan
is an accuser of the
brethren.
Is that true?
Amen.
How many times do we feel bad? How many times do you feel sad over issues of yesterday? Things that's long past. And you know very well that you went before God over that issue. And you asked God to forgive you. And he forgave you. But our enemy comes at a time when you are very happy. Is that right? And he comes and says, hey. Do you remember? You did this? You say yes. You did this? You say yes. And you did this? Then you say yes. The devil wants you to remember all the evil you did. Is that right? And when he makes you remember all the evil, he wants to make sure you are
set.
All your courage goes away. Is that right?
Amen.
That's what the devil does. He is an accuser of the brethren. But brother, in times like that, that's when we need an advocate. Jesus Christ, our advocate. Because you told him everything.
Amen.
Amen. He stands before the judge and stands in for you. Amen. And he says, this one, I died for him. All his sins, I cleaned them away. Is that right? And this man is standing spotless before
you.
He might have done it, but he's justified. And the prophet is justified.
It's
as though you never did it. You never did it. And you come and say, you did this. Says me, what? Why? When? I never did it. To begin with. Why? He justified you. This is what Jesus Christ has done for you. He is our advocate. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He stands in for you. To say, this one is justified. Brother, this is where Christianity is all beginning.
A
Christian does not mean it's a person that was born, he never lied, he never stole peanut butter, he never stole sugar, he never did this, and you went to grade one, you never stole a pencil, you never twisted your face on somebody.
It doesn't mean that.
No. But the problem prophecies in the church and book. It says Israel.
As Israel.
On the whole kind of sin, they
died
it all.
Yes.
But
as
they had an atonement. Is that right? The Christian has got an atonement. Brother, I don't care what you ate. I don't care what you vomited. I don't care where you went into. Under the water, above the water, under the mountain, come through the other side.
Yeah.
That means a lot.
Yeah.
But when you become a Christian, you stand before God. You tell him everything. This is what I did. I'm sorry. I'm very sorry about that. I will never go into those things again. Now you are standing as a Christian. You want to do right. Is that right? He forgives you. He cleans you of all your sins.
Amen.
You stand there justified. Ready to be used by God. Brother, with this kind of a situation, him being in our advocate, this is why you cannot be God. You cannot be God. Brother, that time that sin is using this one.
The way we remember things.
Nobody will ever enter heaven. Oh, but God is good. He's not a man. He is God. Hallelujah. He has no favors with anybody. Amen. He doesn't favor anybody. Is that right? Oh, brother, but we people, hey, brother, we want to know who are you, brother, what is the name of your father?
You are anyway, Papa, and that.
So your father is the one that I went to school with?
Okay.
Okay, so right, come
in.
But with God, brother, it doesn't, it's not like
that.
Because even men was supposed to be in the upper
room.
She was supposed to confess her sin. Is that right? She was supposed to be justified. She was supposed to be in the upper room and receive the Holy Ghost. Also, like everybody else. Amen. That's exactly true. We two brothers and sisters, we must go through the
sin.
If you are a child of a pastor, same process. Deacon's child,
same.
It doesn't matter who you are. You must go through the process.
Because
we got an advocate, the Holy Spirit. That's the one that fights for us.
Amen.
Every day of our lives, we need Him.
Amen.
Amen. May He stand for us in all situations in our life. Amen.
Amen.
You know, you all know the story of Daniel Carey.
Yes, it was Daniel Carey.
Is that right?
Sure.
When he went before the white throne judgment, prophet gives his account.
Prophet,
when he goes there, he had a feeling that you see, me, I was a missionary. Across the seas, made people to cry. Led millions to Christ. So, with me, I'll just walk over. That's what many people think. Is that right? But brother is different.
He
says, when he got there, he stood before that great light. He says, when he saw that light, he could see everything that's evil in him. Is that right? And he was asked, who are you? Amen. I'm Daniel Perry.
Daniel K.
Look at the great. great evangelist.
Amen.
No, you don't go to heaven because of your every words. Before you are a preacher, you must be a Christian. Before you take any office in church, you must be a Christian. So, you don't go to heaven because of your office.
No,
you go to heaven because you're a Christian. He says, we don't find your name here. Your name is not here. But your name is not here.
Amen.
Brother, we all go in by grace.
Yeah.
It's not by our
work.
It's not what we have done.
Amen.
We all go by grace. May His grace be sufficient for us.
Amen.
So it's not what we do. It's just His grace. May His grace
also
be sufficient for us. And may we desire to have that relationship with God. Because that is very important for us.
Amen.
Amen. Let's stand upon our
feet.